standing in front of Buria in the Holocaust Memorial.
Hi, I'm Rachely Benoff, and I'm the Special Projects Coordinator for the museum. So I was in charge of all of the projects that you're going to be seeing. So one thing that really starting out we wanted to have was that the hallway, it's a straight line through, but the walls are sort of creeping in a little bit, and they're dark and oppressive. And so that's really representing what the Jews felt at that time, which was that something bad was happening. And it was a terrible time in history, and it was really, really troubling. But something that we knew was that we had that light at the end of the tunnel where the paper starts turning to blue, which is the Israel section at the end. And if you're just going through the museum, starting out over here at the beginning, like the Jews at that time, they didn't know what was going to happen at the end. They just knew that God has a plan and has something in mind, and everything is going to fit together and work out in the end. But they didn't know what it was. So you can't tell that it's the Israel section. So we're going to be starting out here at the beginning, and now our docents will give you a tour.
Our museum starts in 1919 when the Treaty of Versailles is officially signed. This treaty ends World War I, and right off the bat, Germany is upset because they're blamed for starting the war, and they lose lots of property due to the fact that they lost the war. Years later, in 1922, Mussolini takes over Italy, and he spreads fascism all over Europe. A few years after that, in 1933, Hitler becomes chancellor in Germany, and right after he becomes chancellor, Jews start to realize that they have to leave. This famous quote by Bertolt Brecht is a quote about him leaving Germany and showing how regretful he is that he had to leave all his friends and family behind. I know, of course, it's simply luck that I've survived so many friends, but last night in a dream, I heard those friends say of me, survival of the fittest, and I hated myself. On the other side, you could see a suitcase, which is a demonstration of what Jews would be able to take when they were fleeing Germany. As you could see, they didn't have much room. They were only able to take a few jackets and clothes, and if they were lucky, they were able to take some candlesticks and some books. At the same time in the United States, FDR was elected president, and similarly to Hitler, they were both very charismatic and influential people. They were both able to tell the people what they wanted and get them to agree with them. Over here, you could see what a Nazi flag would look like, and there are many small pictures that make up the Nazi flag. The red pictures represent people who were murdered in the Holocaust. The white pictures represent survivors of the Holocaust, and the black swastika represents members of the Nazi party. Right after Hitler became chancellor, the Reichstag, the German legislature, decided to pass the Enabling Act, which enabled Hitler to monitor the people's art and literature. As you can see here, this would be acceptable art in the eyes of Hitler, which demonstrates Hitler being God and Germany being a superior power in the world. On the other side, you could see work of art that expresses individuality and expression of freedom and color, and therefore he decided that that shouldn't be allowed in Germany, so he burnt it. In 1935, the Nuremberg racial laws were introduced in Germany, taking away all of the Jewish people's civil rights and liberties. Years after that, in 1938, Kristallnacht, also known as the Night of the Broken Glass, took place. And Hitler gave the non-Jews permission to go and torch and burn Jewish shuls, businesses, and schools. As you can see here, this is Hitler's Road to Genocide. As you can see, it starts out with a little book known as Mein Kampf, which Hitler wrote in jail, expressing his hatred towards the Jews. And through the Nuremberg racial laws and the Judenstag, it quickly led to the killing of many millions of Jews. This is a project about a personal family story about several people who died and survived the Holocaust. In the center, you could see a quote by Reuven Rivlin, who wrote about the Jewish center in Europe, Poland. As a Jew, even if you're not born in Poland, the very name Poland gives rise to a shuddering in your body and a longing in your heart. This country was the breeding ground for the soul of the Jewish nation, and unfortunately, also the grounds to the largest Jewish cemetery. Throughout the entire war, there were several Hasidei Umot HaOlam, righteous Gentiles, that saved the Jews from the Nazis. This project is meant to represent Gino Bartali, who was an Italian cyclist who rode his bike throughout Germany and Europe in order to save several Jews. What he did was he put fake papers in his handlebars in order to give to the Jews to help them escape. And as you can see, we intentionally put the bike facing the beginning of the museum in order to show that he helped people escape from the museum and escape the horrors of Germany that were about to come to all the Jewish people.
Hi, my name is Michal Winkler, and I'm going to give you a tour of the war section. Soon after the war started, the Jews were being deported in cattle cars to Auschwitz. This is the maximum amount of space that a Jew would have in a cattle car. You can see the railroad tracks on the ceiling leading into the sign that says Arbeit macht frei, which means work sets you free. This sign was hanging above many concentration camps. It was meant to trick the Jews into thinking that they would come out of it and give them hope, when in reality the Germans had no intention of the Jews coming out of the war. While all of this was going on in Germany, some attention was turned away from then and to America. The Japanese had bombed Pearl Harbor, which brought America and Japan into the war. This is a map of Russia where Babi Yar took place. Babi Yar was a mass grave where Jews, Gypsies, and Ukrainians were all killed. This is a quote by a resistance leader in the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising. "What really matters is that the dream of my life has become true. Jewish self-defense in the Warsaw Ghetto has become a fact. Jewish armed resistance and retaliation have become reality. I have been witness to the magnificent struggle of the Jewish fighters." And underneath, you can see authentic newspapers from the 1940s in America with a skeleton hand grasping on a shadow of barbed wire. In these newspapers, if you can read it, you can see little or no mention at all of Jews during this time. This is a quote by Michael Vogel. He said, "After 2 weeks at Auschwitz, your eyes would swell up from water. Your whole face would be blown up. Your legs would pop, and then you became a skeleton. Electric fences were built around the concentration camp." This is an electric fence made by some students in the engineering program that buzzes and vibrates so that visitors can feel it. It wasn't even a fraction of what the real fences were. This woman was considered a hero during the war. Her name was Miriam Pritchard, and she kept a Jewish family in her home for 3 years. When the Nazis would come to her house to check it, the Jews would go and hide. But one day the Jews came out too early, and she was forced to kill this Dutch Nazi policeman and put him in a casket with another body later that night. Although many Jews were saved during the Holocaust, many of them did not survive. Terezin was a concentration camp meant to trick the Red Cross. When the Red Cross would come, the Jews would draw, write poems, paint, and even go swimming. But when the Red Cross left, they were deported to Auschwitz, and the next group would be sent to Terezin to start this cycle all over again. These are names of people who had died in Terezin. Each butterfly has a name and where the person was deported from. In 1945, the atrocities of the concentration camps were revealed. And this project shows to what extent the Germans brought the Jews to Auschwitz, the red pin representing Auschwitz. They really came from all over Europe. D-Day was when the Allied powers landed on Normandy beaches in order to fight the Nazis. Here you see the German plane is broken by the American plane. On D-Day, General Eisenhower made a broadcast that visitors can listen to. Also made by some engineering students is a motion sensor tank, which is a replica of the one that we used during World War II. This map shows the Nazi reign over Europe. You can see that they took over almost all of Europe except for Italy, which still belonged to the Allied powers.
This is a drawing made by Eleanor Greed of the battles that they and the children and their father actually fought. This is a quote by Michael Jacobs. As you stretched out your arm, the Germans dehumanized the Jews by giving them their numbers. They stripped them of their names, of their families, of their clothing, and of necessities like food. This is a pale, bloody hand, and you can see the number on it, with what is supposed to be barbed wire wrapped around it. This is a marionette made by a student. You can see the man in the striped pajamas, which was what the Jews were forced to wear, with the number on his head. And you can see that he's held up by a swastika and what appears to be barbed wire to show that the Jews were dead. Dr. Mengele, also known as the Angel of Death, performed cruel experiments on many people, but he particularly targeted twins. This project was made by two twins in our school.
After the war, there were some activities that were that shed some light on what happened during the war and later on affected later on culture. One of these things was Rosie the Riveter and Victory Gardens. Rosie the Riveter brought up that women can do a lot of things that men can do, and Victory Gardens were gardens that were in the backyards of anyone, anywhere, in their backyards, in their by their windowsills. Over here, another activity that shed some light onto what happened during the war were the Code Talker program that happened over World War II. The way the Navajo Indians communicated helps the America in the war. Another thing that happened during the war, after the war, was Raoul Wallenberg disappeared from Russia. He saved many, many lives during the Holocaust. And those Jews that he couldn't save were memorialized in different memorials. For example, this is from a replica of a park theme memorial, which is gravestones that represent each city that were destroyed during the Holocaust in Germany. Over here is a plaque that was wood burned to represent the people who were burned during the Holocaust. Those are the names in the background. And in the middle are two hands that are going up from being wrapped in barbed wire to be wrapped in Jewish mitzvot and tefillin. Another way to memorialize the Holocaust were books that were published. One of those is the Diary of Anne Frank that explained how she survived. In her book, it explains the bookcase that is shown here that moved to show the annex leading up to her apartment where she hid until she was discovered. This is a quote by Anne Frank that reads, "In spite of everything, I still believe that people are really good at heart." And here is the book that folded inside of it has a Jewish star. The book is Mein Kampf. That's in spite of Hitler, that even though he's dead, we're still alive. And under it is a book made by people in this class that has a book of people who died during the Holocaust and places to write inside of it. To add. In this bookcase are books that were published during that time period. Another person who wrote books about the Holocaust was Elie Wiesel, who wrote many, many survival books about the Holocaust and died this past year. This is a famous quote said by Elie Wiesel. It reads, "Never shall I forget the first night in camp which has turned my life into one long night. Never shall I forget that smoke, the little faces of the children whose bodies I saw turned into wreaths of smoke. Never shall I forget that nocturnal silence which deprived me for all eternity of the desire to live. Never shall I forget these things, even if I am condemned to life as long as God Himself. Never." After the Holocaust, people tried to put to justice some of the horrors that happened during the Holocaust and World War II. So in America, the Japanese internment camps were closed. And in Europe, the Nuremberg trials took place, which put to justice some of the Nazis who did horrible things during World War II and the Holocaust. Question is, what will you do to express your Jewish pride for the state of Israel and the Jewish people?
After we finish the war section of the museum, we come into the Israel section. starts with this sign over here, Bruchim Habayim, which is a replica of the sign that's above the gates to the old city of Yerushalayim. Over here, there are a pair of pictures that were made showing Israel then and now to show that the people who created it in the past are still the people who are inside its spirit today. This is a video of a relative of one of our students who is a Holocaust survivor. People like him were the ones who really made Israel to what it is today, which is why one of its biggest tenets is the idea of never again. The purpose of the State of Israel is to make sure that never again are the Jews left without a homeland, without any sort of recourse when someone like the Nazis or Hitler wants to destroy them. We have a little bit on the creation of the State of Israel, starting all the way in 1917 with the Balfour Declaration, then to the British Mandate of Palestine, then the Partition Plan. After the Partition Plan was passed in 1947, came the Israel's War of Independence in 1948. This is when Israel gained its independence. It's also the first in a long series of wars that took place over the years. Over here, there are the wars of 1967, the Sinai War, the Yom Kippur War, and there have also been many attempts for peace, including the Camp David Accords and the Oslo Accords. Despite our best efforts, of course, there is not yet true peace in Israel. There are still worries about the threats of places like of people in places like Iran and Hamas. Over here we have three murals of Israel. This one is a mural of Rosh HaNikra, which is the place that many survivors, their boats docked when they first came to Israel. The picture is cut up into different squares to show that really the people who came had nothing. Their lives had been shattered, and here they were trying to piece together their lives, their nation, their national pride, and Israel itself. Over here is a picture of a view of the old city at night. And over here is a picture of the Golan Heights at sunrise to show that really the theme of our museum and of our history is that however dark the night, there is always a sunrise approaching at the end.
I'm Michaela, and I'm a coordinator of the 1.5 million penny memorial. We are raising 1.5 million pennies, which is the equivalent of $15,000, in memory of the 1.5 million Jewish children that were killed in the Holocaust. The money raised will be donated to various organizations, all of which help Jewish children grow and strive, be educated, and lead happy lives in ways that the children of the Holocaust never got a chance to. So one of the organizations that we are donating to will be Crib Efrat, which helps Jewish pregnant women who would like to have their children but are in financial difficulties. It gives them money so that they can raise their children. Another one is Beit El Ezraki, which helps children in Netanya, Israel, that are in difficult homes where the parents are deemed unfit to raise their children. They're taken out of these homes and they are provided with an education and a home and a happy life. And the third place will be the Jewish Educational Center Scholarship Fund, so that children can have a nice education if they can't afford it.
Okay, I guess it's time for me to make a comment about the museum. And I remember the day when I took the girls into the hall and I said, this is a bare hallway. I do that every year. And it's with a certain degree of anticipation and trepidation that we begin the process. But I thought this year, the very nature of the choices, the staff, and somehow, pretty much the way it's been every year, the right girls are in the right place, in the right class, with the right attitude. And we put together a small miracle at Berea High School. And I think the girls will always remember, and I'll remember what they accomplished. It certainly was magic, not just in the classroom, but magic in the hallway, too. I thank everyone involved.